time. And then I'll go through some basics, like we have some questions about stall calls, what your role is to keep kids safe, a lot of one parent's already asked me, my wrestler had a lot of legal calls against him or technical violation calls. What are some of those? For more experienced wrestlers, what's loss of control? And when do they actually lose control? And then there are certain positions where they feel like they got the takedown. So what are the points of contact for truly taking the takedown? But with that, let's just get started with what is your expectation from your vantage point as a referee?
As I mentioned before, as a referee, first thing I expect is sportsmanship. Are you gonna shake the hands you wrestle before, shake the hands after, be courteous. Know that this is a tough sport. Your opponent, hopefully, is not there to hurt you. This is a tough sport. And as I get into the reffing, the wrestling part of it later, I'm gonna tell you that the object that I have as a wrestler is sometimes to make a wrestler do what you want to do, you have to inflict a little pain. But you learn to inflict some pain without injury. And that's very, very important. That's the one thing that I love about wrestling that's different from all other contact or martial arts type sports, is you trying to make somebody do something that they don't want to do without hurting them, without striking them, without making them tap out by going against a joint. These are things that are illegal in wrestling. That's extremely hard to do. That's what makes this sport so great. I expect the wrestlers to be aggressive. If one wrestler is aggressive and the other one is not, that the non-aggressive wrestler is going to get called for stalling. So I expect you to be aggressive. I expect you to be fair. I expect you not to try to sneak in illegal moves. You will look for those. So that's pretty much my expectations of wrestlers. Wrestle hard, wrestle the best you can. Don't try anything illegal. Good sportsmanship, be aggressive. That's what I'm looking for in a good match.
Perfect. All right, before he gets started, is there any questions you guys have that just you've been dying to ask a referee? Zoe.
Yes. What's considered a chokehold?
What, a chokehold? So, there's, one of my favorite things when I hear on a mat is, he's choking me, he's choking me. Well, if you can say it. You want to choke me? Well, make some gurgly noise. But if you're speaking to me, that means you got enough breath to be able to breathe in and then formulate words.
Well, that's a good point.
Hurt. It may be uncomfortable. It may not feel good. But you are not in danger.
Yeah.
You can breathe. If you can speak, you can breathe.
So this actually happens a lot when you're putting your opponent in a half Nelson. Can someone show me a half Nelson real quick? Five, four, three, two. Okay. Half Nelson comes in. Deep. She runs it. Let her have it, Alicia. Okay, and suddenly Alicia starts going. Go ahead.
I'm joking, I'm joking.
You know what I'm going to do when I start hearing that? I'm going to be looking at that shoulder. I'm going to hit.
Thank you.
That's the quickest way to get someone who feels that you're in danger off the mat.
Okay. Other questions, wrestlers? Come on.
How can wrestling control? Okay. That's the one thing that's different, again, in folk style, freestyle, and wrestling. Freestyle and wrestling, you cannot pin yourself. In folk style, you can.
So the question was, can you pin yourself?
Can you pin yourself? Yes, you can pin yourself.
Someone give me a crab ride?
So, basically, a pin area is from the top of your shoulders to the middle of your back. That whole area is a pinning combination. So if you have any of that area, both sides, touching the mat for 2 full seconds, you are pinned. And it does not matter if you are the offensive wrestler or the defensive wrestler.
Can you show it on their back? So Julian, turn around, face us, and then John, if you can show the pinning.
Here, I think you're going to be in front, but if he starts to pull him back, and I'm going to come over here, I'm going to look in here. I'm going to go 1-1000, 2-1000. And I'm going to call the pin.
Can you show the pinning area on Julian? Julian, please stand up and give us your back.
top of the shoulders to the middle of the back. It does not have to be the scapulas.
How deep that is on the
pinned. This area down here, and that happens a lot in a cradle, where he says, I'm not pinned, my shoulders weren't down. That's still pinning area, both sides. That's still a pin. Okay? I had a situation where I was wrestling. This is at the Folkestyle National Championships. And this is a Folkestyle match. This is in Cedar Falls, Iowa. I was behind by a couple points. Time was running out. Person put the legs in. I quickly sat out, did a high back bridge with one hand, because I can't use both hands. I used one hand and grabbed his head. The referee's looking at me over on that side, and I'm looking up at him. I'm saying, he's pinned. I didn't say it, I mouthed it. And the guy came around, took a look, and he's going 5, 4, 3, calls the pin. And then time came in. Went over, shook hands. He rose my hand, this guy went ballistic. He thought he'd won the match because he was ahead by points and time ran out.
Yeah.
He didn't realize I had pinned him. You can
unload questions.
Pin. Any other questions?
Unload your questions.
Okay. We had people send a question. So the first one was, how much time is reaction time?
And what is reaction time, I guess? So,
right.
So someone show me a takedown. Quick. And then recover really quickly. Test, recover.
That right there would have been a takedown and an escape.
Okay.
Because what happened, weight went down on the hands, a knee went down, they were covering the hips, and that's a takedown.
Okay.
Go 2 takedown and immediately call 1 escape.
Someone show me a mat return with recovery. Quick. All right, so here's a mat return, but don't go all the way down. Well, I said, okay. Reverse it, Alicia, you're in front. There we go, pick her up. Don't let your hand touch the ground. Okay?
If they had done an arm drag out behind, it would take down and not been scored. Yep, that's not a takedown.
What if Alicia just lightly glanced her hand to the ground?
There's got to be weight. Like,
so she picks me up, and I do that.
No, I probably would not call that. Last year that made the call. This year, what they're saying is there's got to be some sort of weight bearing on it for it to actually be called. So basically, if you were going down, and just out of instinct, your hand kind of brushes, you probably won't call that a takedown. But if you didn't put your hand down and you would have fallen, we're going to have to call that. You basically, you're stopping yourself from going to the mat by putting your hand down. That is weight bearing on the hand. We would call that as a takedown.
But it's so fast. Right. When you consider reaction time, is that what?
What I'm kind of looking for in that situation is pretty much what I said. If I felt that without that hand going down, that person would have gone to the mat, I would have called that a takedown. They prevented themselves from going to the mat. They prevented the takedown by putting weight on that hand. That to me is a takedown.
Anna?
Our next one was, what is the most successful wrestling technique from a referee vantage point?
Good question, 45 years of experience.
Okay.
No pressure.
I am a true believer, and I'll go over this thing again, you pin to win. You can be behind 14-0 with 10 seconds left in the match, and you can win that match by pinning your opponent. So, and pinning has become a lost art. And I can show techniques today on how to finish, how to actually pin.
Yeah, start there. You have.
Because if you get someone on your back, we used to have a saying is that there are no escapes. What I'm talking about is there's no escapes off a person, off your back. Once you get a person on their back, you should pin them. They should not be able to get off their back, and you should be able to make the adjustments necessary to pin them. Does that answer the question, or are you looking for something else?
The next one is, how and when is a near fall awarded?
It's a near fall awarded. You must get past 45-degree angle. You must hold it at that 45-degree angle for at least 2 seconds to be able to get a near fall. there are times when you push some, push someone back, especially you get like a tilt, right? You're tilting and they get, and you're looking, you're just at that 45, and you get a one and they come back up. It's a one count, they come back and it's a one, and they come back up. And that's why we verbalize, so you understand that that wasn't a one and a two, that was a one and a one and a one and a one and a two. Now you got it. Has to be past 45 degrees, and it has to be in these 2 seconds, two full seconds. Yes.
Question over here too.
Okay, going back.
Yes.
Kind of connected to the last question. What wrestling style have you seen be the most successful? I know there's like one that you can point to, but
like I said, usually in most wrestling situations, the aggressive wrestler is going to be the winning wrestler. Okay. But then again, personally, I'm very much a counter wrestler. I like to see what the other person's going to do, and I have a lot of moves that counter what they do and put them on their back and pin them. So I like to see a lot of good counter wrestlers. I like to see ones. I like to see wrestlers that take advantage. So if a person shot shoots and you stop them, a reshot should come right away. Using your opponent to your advantage. That's kind of style I like. Yes. Okay.
Show me locked hands. Two. No, like anyone.
Okay.
So we're doing this for the parents too, so they understand these calls. Go ahead. Locked hands.
I'm sorry. So is it? Do a switch. So one of you do a switch, and as the person switching, lock the hand.
Kylie, Gwen, help me out.
That person locks the hands right there. Okay, there's the lock hands. That's probably one of the more common places you're going to get locked hands when people are trying to switch. Someone's coming around, you reach around. Now, that's not locked hands. That's double tight waist. Now locked hands. Some referees will call that. I don't. Okay? Because they're touching. Okay? Lock hands means you're locking hands. Okay? So cover, sometimes I will not call that. A lot of times in a switch, a person is trying to reach around the waist and just slap their own hand. That's not a locked hands to me. Locking hands is locking the hands and preventing someone from actually completing a move or doing something. You lock and you pull, or you lock and you keep them. That's what I'm looking for with locked hands. Just happen to slap, just happen to touch. If you're doing a couple tight ways like that, I'm not going to call those. Got to be a lock. Got to be a lock.
So one thing I see a lot is this happening. So I come up. She locks up the body, yeah. And this person knows that if I go down and she stays,
correct.
So you see some people we use as a strategy.
Yes.
Down. So how do you feel about that?
This actually, they've actually changed this rule. They actually have put this rule in where it is now an unsportsmanlike conduct. It's 1 point for your opponent for purposely going down to the mat to try to get a locking hands call. I was at a tournament. The person was on the mat. The person locked the hands. I came up with a locked hand signal. He then stood up almost immediately. So when you're on your feet, you have a locked hands, you let that continue because the person worked very hard to get to the feet. You're gonna give them a chance to score. If they don't, you're gonna get the locked hands. So I had the locked hands, but I'm not going to walk around like this. I'm going to do it once. I got the locked hands. Now I know who had the lock. I'm going to put it down. I'm going to watch and see what this person does. And what did that person do? This person was trying to let him go. He grabbed the wrists,
held his hands together, went down to a knee and says, he's locked on hands. What did I do? I went 1 point, locking hands, green. Unsportsmanlike conduct on green, 1 point red. Coach went nuts.
So this other thing I've been seeing a lot too on that mat return is Kylie again. So I get up, I'm up, and then they go drop to the leg.
Mm-hmm.
They drop to the leg all the way to the ground. Just the key here.
Yes. Now, in those situations, so you said it's not an escape to the other way. So that's one of your techniques is when it starts to turn, is when you drop down and grab the leg. If they're down on the leg and they're not trying to come up to cover, they get called for stall. Okay? There's no time limit, but I'm going to be looking to see, is this person making an effort to continue climbing up? This person is just hanging on and he's dragging them across the mat. Now, I'm going to give him time, but I'm eventually probably going to hit him with a stall call.
Right? And how bad are stall
persons on top in that situation? They're the one that was in control and they're still in control. When you call stalling in that situation, you have to stop the match. And then they'll be put back down in the top bottom position. If a bottom person is stalling, the match continues. And you don't call it. You can call stalling, but you don't stop it. If they're on their feet, you call stalling, you don't stop it. Only if the top man is stalling do you call it. Because the bottom man can't do anything under a stalling situation, you're giving them a chance to restart and a better situation to where then they can get away. Yes, you have a question.
When kids have a long season,
yes,
they start to bring extra gear to the mat.
Extra
gear like knee pads and elbow pads and KT tape. What's acceptable and what's really not acceptable that you've noticed that you had to tell a wrestler, I'm sorry?
This year, again, another new rule they put in. Arm sleeves, leg sleeves are only legal if they have a pad in it, if they have an elbow pad or a knee pad. So the basketball, you know, the one arm, nice long sleeves, those are no longer legal. You cannot wear those. Unless they are designed for wrestling that have a pad sewn into it. It's not just pulled over a knee pad. It has to be a part of the sleeve. Okay? Any equipment that you wear is safe as long as it does not restrict movement and it is padded and covered. So knee braces. If it's padded knee braces and they can still do full extension of their leg, that's perfectly legal. Okay. The tape, that's legal. Okay. If it starts to come off and it's interfering, you may ask them to remove it for the rest of the match. But it's not illegal in itself. Also, one other thing on equipment and things like headgear. It must be used and it must be as designed by the manufacturer. So like if you have the headgear that have the two straps that go across, the two straps in the back, you cannot cross them. That is not the way it's designed.
I don't
like that rule personally. I would say that I don't see why you can't. Just because it comes in the box with the straps uncrossed doesn't mean you shouldn't be able to cross them. I don't think that makes a difference as far as I'm concerned. And you can't take what you can't take. You can't put tape on it. Same thing with the singlet. If your singlet's a little bit loose, you can't tape the back. You can't tape it together. Because that's not the way it was originally designed.
There's a new rule for the girls too. Kylie, can you stand up? Can you walk us through the new hair rule? So
yes.
Kylie has put her hair in a bun, and her hair is no longer at the collar. Could she start wearing this to competition?
Yes. So, like I said, there's a few new rules. I want to go over those real quick. We'll go over the hair rule first, because that was mentioned. The hair rule is and has always been and still is, it cannot be below the eyebrows, it cannot be below the bottom of the earlobe, it cannot be below the collar. If it is, you have to do one of two things. You have to have it in a hair covering, and it all goes underneath the hair covering, and that hair covering must be attached to your headgear, or you must have it secured. And the way you secure it is with a rubber band
can be, you know, with black, you know, the normal black ones. It doesn't have to be a yellow, you know, it doesn't have to be.
So like in this case, as a referee, what would you?
So that is perfectly legal, okay? If your hair was long as, and the rule now rule is, you have long hair, you put it in, and it is secured with a rubber band, and that hair is down your back all the way to your heels, it's legal.
Illegal, anyone want to just have legal.
No, you do not.
That's good. That's all we did.
Like I said, you have it as long as you want, as long as it's secured. Now, if you have it secured and you have bangs that are going below your eyebrows, that's not legal. Meaning you have to put it, you either have to put a hair cover or you have to make it where that extra hair goes into the band, into the rubber band.
For the sake of time, we want to use the next 20 minutes to really clear more technical questions. So, coaches, do you have Coach Dormer?